The smallest unit of meaning in a language is called a morpheme. Let's take a lovely English word, inconceivable. There are three morphemes there. Conceive, which in this context means to form something in your head. Now, you could break that down further if we were in old Latin, but in English, that is a morpheme. Con and sieve don't mean anything on their own here. Then we've got able, which means the possibility of something. Conceivable. We can think about this. And then we've got in, which negates it. Inconceivable. We cannot possibly think about this. Different languages have very different approaches on how to deal with morphemes, and those approaches are the reason why some languages have many short words, and others have long structures that are frequently difficult for adults learning a new language to deal with. There is a spectrum, and it stretches from analytic to synthetic. Over on the analytical side, there are the isolating languages, like Chinese and Vietnamese. Here, each morpheme is usually an entirely separate word. Assembling a sentence in one of these languages means you're mostly picking and choosing words and putting them next to each other. Next along the spectrum, there are the agglutinative languages, like Turkish and Inuktitut. Agglutinative, it's a lovely word, has the same Latin roots as the word glue. You're gluing words together from their component parts. So rather than picking extra words to add to your sentence, you are adding prefixes or suffixes to words that are already there. Now, depending on the language, you might add affixes for tense, person, number, belonging, possession, or even things like whether an action was deliberate or not. Next up are the fusional languages. Now, they work in the same way, assembling bits to make a full word with all the meaning you want. But now the bits you're adding affect the parts you've got already, tweaking how it looks or how it sounds. Not only that, but each of the bits you're adding can have multiple different meanings attached to it. Tense, number, person, all sorts of things can be coded with just one sound attached to a word. Take hablo in Spanish. That O morpheme, it means first person, singular, present, indicative. That's a lot of meaning in a very short sound. And then, all the way over here, are the polysynthetic languages. Basically, the really, really extra synthetic languages. You'll find this in Algonquin languages, up in the cold parts of North America. This is where you can combine potentially a dozen or more morphemes, enough for a whole sentence, a whole coherent thought, into one long word. And it really is a word. The individual parts can't be split apart and survive on their own. The morphemes you're using might be agglutinative in separate blocks, or they might be fusional, affecting everything around them. But at any rate, you have an entire sentence in the form of one beautiful, long, interconnected word. Now here's the thing, most English speakers consider polysynthetic languages to be the crazy side of language. It seems incredibly complicated. And for adults trying to learn a polysynthetic language, it is incredibly confusing. But children may actually find these languages easier to learn because the words are long and intertwined and each bit affects another. So there's more redundancy there. If you mishear or misunderstand one part, you are much more likely to be able to work out what was meant from how all the words around it have changed. It's important to remember that, like many things in life, this is a spectrum. There aren't many languages that fit neatly into any one of these categories. English is actually a fairly isolating language down at this end of the scale, but it's still gradually classified as synthetic because we've got many, many words like inconceivable. And the family that English belongs to, Indo-European, is pretty synthetic too. And while this is the conventional approach to classifying languages, it does have a few problems. It distinguishes loads of different categories on this side of the spectrum, but it lumps all the isolating languages together. That's probably because most of the linguists who set up the classification, particularly the early ones, were European, so they concentrated on the differences that made sense to them. Languages are messy things that shift and change over time between places and people. Categorising them can be useful for research, and it tells you a few things about the possibilities of what the human brain can do, but once you start to file them away, you start to realise that, like most everything about human communication, they really don't fit into neat little boxes.